But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Five hundred years have gone by. Abraham begat Isaac, who begat Jacob, who begat Joseph. And Joseph was sent into the land of Egypt for the salvation of his people. He was sent into Egypt by God, as we studied last week, and we saw how God worked in and through Joseph to bless not only the Egyptians, but also all of the world during the time of the famine. Joseph and his family resided in the land of Goshen in the area in the country of Egypt, and they lived there for many years peacefully among the Egyptian people. And there arose another Pharaoh some several hundred years after Joseph, who did not remember Joseph and all that God had done through Joseph for his nation. He looked at the foreigners in the land of Egypt and he saw nothing but trouble coming. He expected that if anybody came down to invade the land, that the people known as the Hebrews, or the children of Israel as we would call them, if the invading forces came, the Pharaoh was afraid that they would join with the enemy forces to defeat Pharaoh and the Egyptian army. And so the Pharaoh that did not know Joseph began to oppress the people, the children of Israel. And he declared that the firstborn sons, or the sons of all of the Israelites, the Hebrew people, would be put to death upon their birth. He gave instructions to the midwives for this to occur. But the midwives did not always follow his edict. And there was a child born to a Levite couple. This child was placed, was fed secretly and cared for secretly by his mother for about a period of 3 months. And then when he got old enough, his mother refused to have him killed. And so she put him in a basket. And she put him in the papyrus reeds near the area where the princess of the Pharaoh would come, the daughter of Pharaoh, the princess of Egypt, would come to bathe. And when she came that day, she found the baby in the basket. And Miriam, his sister, was standing by watching what was happening. And when the princess found this baby and she heard him crying, her instincts went to care for this child. And Miriam comes out and says to him, to her, "Do you want me to find someone to care for this baby?" And the princess of Egypt said, "Yes." And she named the baby Moses, because he had been drawn out of the water, drawn out of the river. Miriam took her brother home to his mother, and there she continued to raise him and to teach him as a young child about the God that she worshipped, about the people that he was a part of. And then when he was weaned, he was taken into the court of the Pharaoh, and there he was raised as a prince in the court of Pharaoh. For 40 years, Moses lived in the palace of the Pharaoh. He grew in wisdom and in stature. He grew in an understanding of the ways of the Egyptians. He knew what it was like to be royalty. And then, one day, he was out, and he saw an Egyptian taskmaster beating one of his Hebrew brothers. He became a murderer at that point, as he killed the Egyptian and buried his body in the sand, thinking that no one would ever know. The next day, he sees two Hebrew men fighting with each other, and he tries to separate them. And one says to him, "Are you going to kill me like you killed the Egyptian?" And so Moses learned that what he had done, he felt secretly, was now out in the open. He now had a price tag on his head. Here he was, living in the court of the Pharaoh, and now he has killed an Egyptian, and he must flee for his life. And he goes out into the desert. And there, he finds a family. There he finds a home. And for 40 years, he walks through the Sinai desert, keeping Reuel, his father-in-law's sheep. For 40 years, he wanders from watering hole to watering hole, finding the little bit of grass and food that his sheep could eat. For 40 years, he's a shepherd. For 40 years, he was a prince. And then one day, he comes to a mountain, to the mountain called Horeb, or the Mount of Horeb, the Mount of Sinai. And there he sees in the distance a fire burning on a bush. And he walks up and he sees that the bush is not consumed. It is still there, but the fire is there also. And Moses walks up and all of a sudden he hears a voice who speaks to him and says, "Moses, here I am. Take off your shoes. Take off your sandals, for the ground that you are standing on is holy ground." And there, God speaks to Moses. And he says, "Moses, I want you to go back to the land of Egypt. I want you to take your family and go to the land of Egypt, and I want you to go into the palace that you are so familiar with. I want you to go before the Pharaoh that treated you much as a father would treat a son. I want you to go as a murderer condemned to death and stand before Pharaoh and say to Pharaoh, 'God says, let my people go.'" Wow. Here I am, Moses. "God, you want me to go back there where I'm going to die? God. I can't speak well. Stutter. I'm not a good speaker. Moses, I've got Aaron coming to you. Aaron's your brother. He will speak for you. God's ways are not our ways. God's thoughts are not our thoughts. Who am I, God, to go on a mission trip? Who am I, God, to go to a foreign land and there live and speak on your behalf? Who am I, God, to be able to talk to the people in St. John and share with them my story about how you have worked in my life? As we look at the story of the deliverance of the Hebrew children, the children of Israel, from their land of slavery, we see that God chose a person that He had prepared to do His bidding. When Moses was in the Pharaoh's palace, when Moses was in the wilderness, he had no idea what God had in store for him. Moses was living his life, was happy, contented, had no thought about what God had said to his ancestor Abraham. And suddenly God appears and says to him, I want you to do this task for me. Now, God didn't say to Moses, I have prepared you for 80 years to do this task. He says, here's a task. And Moses, down on his earthly level, said to God on his upper level, God, I'm incapable of doing what you want me to do. I cannot do it. God says, I will be with you. How many times have you said to God, or have I said to God, I'm incapable, Lord, of doing what you want me to do? My story is a story of obedience to God at times when I did what I wasn't expecting to be able to do. I was obedient and God was with me. To us here today, God says, I want you to reach out and to touch and to minister to the people of St. John. I want you, as First Southern Baptist Church of St. John, to reach out and to minister. I know that you are small. I know that you are senior citizens. I know that all of the excuses you can give to me for not doing what I want you to do. I want you to do and to trust and to believe that God, that I will be with you. I don't know exactly what God has for us to do as a church in particular, but I do know that He wants us to be doing something, and He is going to give us that task. And then all we have to do is to trust Him to carry it through and to bring out the results. You see, God calls people that do not know their own power. He called Moses. And you know, Moses was a nobody. Moses gave all kinds of excuses of why he could not do what God wanted him to do. But you know, Moses was successful not because he had the power, not because he was anybody, but because God worked through him. And God got the glory. And so here is a nobody who follows God's will and does what he is told to do, and God is with him. And he goes and he stands before Pharaoh. He has talked to the leaders of the children of Israel, and he now goes before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh and says to Pharaoh, "Hey Pharaoh, I met God out in the wilderness. God told me to come and tell you, Pharaoh, let my people go. These people that you are using as slaves, these people that you have oppressed, let them go. God says to." And Pharaoh looks at down at Moses from his palace seat and he says, "Moses, I don't know your God. Why should I let them go?" You see, Moses had all, I mean not Moses, but Pharaoh had all kinds of gods that he worshipped. I don't know how many gods there were in Egypt, but there were a whole slew of them. And even Pharaoh himself was considered to be a god. And Pharaoh looks at Moses and he says, "I don't know your God. Why should I let his people go? They are my slaves. They're building my storehouses. They're doing my work. I'm not going to let them go." And so God begins to deliver his people with a mighty hand. With a mighty right arm, God begins to speak to Pharaoh and to show to Pharaoh, "I am God. Beside me there is no other God." So Moses has Aaron throw down his rod that he walked with. And the rod of Aaron became a serpent, a snake. And all of the magicians in the presence of Pharaoh threw down their rods, and they too became snakes. They had the power. But the rod of Aaron, the snake, that it became, ate up the snakes of the Egyptians. Aaron reached down and picked up that snake, and it became his rod again, his staff that he walked with. Moses told Pharaoh, "God says, let my people go." And Pharaoh's heart became hardened against the children of Israel, just as the Lord had said would happen. And then Moses said to Pharaoh, God says, if you do not let my people go, all of the water in the land, the water of the Nile, is going to become blood. And sure enough, it did. And sure enough, the Egyptian magicians were able to turn water into blood also. But Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he did not let the people go. He told Moses, pray. So Moses did, and the water became water again. But Pharaoh still would not let the people go, and so God sent a plague of frogs. Now every one of the 10 plagues in Egypt, every one of them, was a deliberate occurrence that God created, that God caused to happen, to show to Pharaoh, your gods that you worship are not gods. Every plague defeated at least one or more of the gods of Egypt who the Egyptians worshiped. In Sunday school, I can give you the names of all of them. I'll read it. I'll read down the list for you just so that you can see. Okay? But then God sends another plague, a plague of frogs. And the Egyptian, the magicians again, do the same thing. They bring out more frogs. And Moses goes to Pharaoh and says, Pharaoh, what you want me to do? Or Pharaoh calls Moses and says, look, pray to the Lord to take the frogs from me. And Moses asks a question. He says, Pharaoh, when do you want me to pray? And I will never understand this until the day I die. And I will have to get in heaven and find out why Pharaoh said what he did. But when his land is covered with frogs, both brought about by God and by the magicians, and Moses says to Pharaoh, when do you want me to pray that these frogs will be taken away from you? And Pharaoh looks at Moses and says, tomorrow. Pray tomorrow. I'll put up with this one more day. Doesn't make sense. Frogs are taken away and then the gnats come. Now, the magicians are not able to multiply the number of gnats. And they say to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. We can duplicate what God has done only to a certain point. And now the finger of God is laying upon us. Let his people go. And Pharaoh refused. Now, each time you read one of the plagues, the ending verse of each plague says one or two things. It says either that Pharaoh hardened his heart, or God hardened his heart. You see, when God acts, people's hearts are either melted or hardened because of what God has done. Stephen Hawking, one of the most brilliant men who has ever lived, he has a brilliant mind. He is scientific. He can answer almost any question scientifically that you want to have answered. And he has come out and said, science has now gotten to a point where we no longer have a need for God. Science can explain everything. And there is no need for God. And Stephen Hawking came right out and said, I am an atheist. I do not believe that God exists. Neither did Pharaoh. But God got Pharaoh's attention. And with his mighty right arm, he led his people out of captivity. Now, the first started part of the story was about God's choosing a man who was a nobody. A man who had no power. A man who could not speak. And God used him in a mighty way to lead his people out of a land of captivity. And he has a message for you and I. He's got a call for you and me to do the same thing, to lead people out of a land of captivity and sin. But God also used Moses and used the plagues against Egypt to show who he was. A Pharaoh had enslaved God's people, and God said, you will let my people go. Now, how does that apply to you and to me? Who's your Pharaoh? What is your Pharaoh? What person has oppressed you? What circumstance do you find yourself in that you do not know how to get out of? You don't know what's going to happen. You know that the issue of whatever it is oppressing you and holding you down and keeping you from being and becoming all that God would have you to be. What is the Pharaoh in your life? Is there a situation in your life? A conflicted situation where you are oppressed because of the issues surrounding you and another individual, and you are in a conflict and that conflict is holding you down, oppressing you. God delivered his people from oppression of Pharaoh. And he can and he will deliver us from the people, from the conflict, from the circumstance of life that might be oppressing us and keeping us from doing what God wants us to do. God can deliver us. God can deliver you from the circumstances of life, from the individuals in life that are holding you down and keeping you from being all that you want to be, all that He wants you to be. You see, God's story and man's story becomes our story when we look and we understand that God has a plan for us as individuals. And God will enable us to carry out His plan in our lives. And no matter what is holding us back, God can deliver us and will deliver us from it so that we can become the men and women of God that He wants us to be. Let us pray. Father, Your story is magnificent. Your story not only began with Abraham and with the creation, but Your story is a story of deliverance It is a story of caring for your people, of delivering them from pharaonic oppression of various types. It is a story of enabling people to be more than they are themselves because you enable them to become more and greater than they can ever be in their own strength. Father, it is my prayer that you would enable us this day, and that you would enable us as a church, as individuals, to become what you have for us to be and to do. And we take comfort, Lord, in the promise that you will be with us and that you will deliver us from the things that prevent us from becoming the people of God you would have us to be. Thank you for this opportunity to study your word. For your thoughts are not our thoughts, and your ways are not our ways. For it is in your Son's name we do pray.